The notebooks of Charles Darwin, particularly during the late 30s, 1830s, when he was developing the theory of natural selection, where Darwin interrupts his ruminations on the nature of life and evolution to debate another pressing issue, though slightly more personal in nature, which is whether or not he should get married. And Darwin basically creates a pros and cons list. He's debating whether he should marry Emma Wedgwood at this point in his life, which he eventually ends up doing. On the side of not getting married, he said, freedom to go where one liked, choice of society and little of it. Maybe my favorite, conversation of clever men at clubs. Which I like to think that he was thinking about the RSA. On the side of to marry, there's children, if it please God, which is interesting, he writes that as someone who famously became an agnostic later in life. Constant companion and friend in old age. Object to be beloved and played with better than a dog, anyhow, is the line there. So the pros and cons list is the one technique that most of us have learned at some point in our lives for making a complex decision. Franklin is doing this in the 1770s, Darwin's doing it in the 1830s, and the fact that we're still doing it suggested to me that the science of making complex decisions was somewhat stagnant, that surely there were better techniques out there, there were better ways to think about these kinds of choices. A lot of the research that I had read up until this point about decision-making in the brain had been focused on gut decisions, blink decisions in the kind of Malcolm Gladwell phrase, the kind of fast system one brain decisions. And it occurred to me, while that research is incredibly interesting, and there's a lot to be said about it, and we've learned a lot about how we make rapid-fire decisions, that the decisions that really matter the most in our lives should not be instinctive decisions, should not be gut decisions. They require deliberation. They require mulling. They require time and meditation. And when I stumbled across this pros and cons list from Darwin, I was in the middle of my own kind of equivalent decision of trying to decide whether we should move after many years, 20 years living in New York City. I, as a kind of midlife crisis, decided that I must live in California. In thinking about that choice, and thinking about all the different levels of experience and kind of scales of experience that are implicated in a decision like that. Because when you think about moving, say, from the city to the suburbs, you think about all the different values that are at stake in a choice like that, right? There's your own personal happiness, there's the personal happiness of your spouse or your children, there's your relationship towards the city, towards nature. Do you want to live in a sidewalk-centric culture or a car-centric culture? There's, you know, the schools that your kids are moving into, there's the real estate values, all these, there's economics, are all implicated in a choice like that. And so how do you go about making those kinds of decisions? There's a great quote from the Nobel laureate, Thomas Schelling, that gets to this, which is, one thing a person cannot do, no matter how rigorous his analysis or heroic his imagination, is to draw up a list of things that would never occur to him. Right? And in some sense, when we're making these choices, we have to force ourselves to start to imagine things that don't necessarily come to our mind instinctively. One of the key things that comes out of the science and scholarship on this is to divide up these decisions into different phases. Sometimes those phases are known as a divergent and then a convergent phase, where you're trying to come up with lots of alternatives, lots of different factors, not try and narrow down to a final choice, and then you eventually get to a stage where you finally make the decision. I call that initial stage the mapping stage. You're trying to understand all the different variables that are at work in the decision and try and also explore other alternatives, other potential paths that might not have occurred to you originally. There's a wonderful scholar on the kind of business side of this named Paul Nutt, who spent many, many years analyzing real-world corporate decisions and looking at the techniques that people used, or more often than not, the lack of techniques that people used, to make these decisions, and then looking at the outcomes, like were people happy in the end with the decision that they'd made. And he looked at hundreds and hundreds of decisions of, you know, should we launch this new product? Should we shut down this factory here? You know, should we open up this new branch in this new city? All these kind of long-term decisions in the corporate world. And what he found was that most people making decisions did not have a phase in the kind of mapping phase in the early stage of the decision where they actively sought out other alternatives. Most people actually did what Nutt called whether or not decisions, basically, should we do this or not? And they kind of debated this one choice and either pulled the trigger on it or decided not to. And those decisions in general, overall, tended to be unsuccessful ones. But what Nutt found was that there was a small subset of decisions made by folks who took time at the beginning to explore other alternatives. and to think about whether there wasn't another path on the table potentially that they could explore. And folks who took that extra step basically took what Nutt describes as a whether or not decision and turned it into a which one decision. Those decisions were much more likely to end up successful. So that early mapping stage, in a sense, create a list of things that would never occur to you, uncover these other paths, is really important to the process. So great example in the domain of urban planning, there's a lot of discussion in Farsighted about urban planning kind of collective decisions. With all of this research, I think there is a significant case to be made that we should be teaching decision making. There's a great body of research now and tools and strategies to be used. Whatever you end up doing with your life, whatever field you go into, you will use that skill. Even if you have no career, you will need skills in making complex decisions in your life. If you think of all the things in grade school and high school and college that you learned that you never use again after you take that final exam. Decision-making, complex decision-making is a skill that everyone has a need for. And I don't mean this in a purely kind of utilitarian, vocational kind of sense of school, but if you think about what that class would look like, it would be wonderfully multidisciplinary, incredibly diverse in terms of the perspectives that would be brought to the classroom, right? You would learn from behavioral economics, you would learn from the utilitarian philosophers, you would read great novels, you would read about military history, you would read about cognitive science and neuroscience. It would be an incredible mix of different perspectives, but it would all be in the service of a skill that everyone would use one way or another in their lives, personal and public. Thank you.